So it is my tremendous pleasure to introduce Micah Nedegaard, our keynote speaker this afternoon. Micah is professor in the Department of Neurology and Neurosurgery and co-director of the Center for Translational Neuromedicine at the University of Rochester. Micah received her medical and graduate degrees from the University of Copenhagen before doing postdoctoral work at Weill Cornell University. Her lab, the Division of Glial Disease and Therapeutics, studies the contribution of glial to brain function. In 2012, Micah described her groundbreaking research on the waste system of the brain called the glymphatic system. Her work has continued to advance knowledge on how astrocytes and their link to the lymphatic system contribute to clearance of metabolites and waste products. These functions have implications for the role of sleep and disease such as Alzheimer's, autism, and stroke. So we are very fortunate to have Micah with us today. The title of her talk is The Glymphatic System. Please.
Thank you to the organizing committee. I think it's all here. So that was a really sweet introduction. And I'm going to talk about fluid flow in the brain. And it's a little intimidating at MIT to discuss basically a plumbing system, because many of the hallmark papers on information processing, decision making, encoding, actually have been published out of studies made at MIT. So I'm back to the housekeeping function of the brain, and this is what I would discuss. And since a lot of this fluid flow within multicellular tissue has been defined better in peripheral tissue, I would first start with that. So as soon as you have more than a couple of cells, so if you're not a bacteria, but if you start to have several cells, you need a vascular system to provide you nutrients and oxygen. Very simple. But also, you cannot have all your cells located right next to a capillary. So you basically create in peripheral tissues, you create fluid within the tissue as a local delivery path of primarily glucose, free fatty acids, amino acid, and so on. So if you look at a peripheral vessel here, you'd see that it is leaky. We don't have a blood-brain barrier, of course. So here we have a peripheral capillary on the arterial side. And we would have glucose that need to enter to get into cell that's located far away from the capillary. And you'd basically set up a local stream of fluid within the tissue. And what is driving that? Very simple, it's a systolic blood pressure. So it's pressure driving the fluid in, and you have these endothelial cells that's coupled by gap junction, not by tight junctions. And they are covered by the glycocalyx extracellular matrix protein that allow certain molecules like albumin and smaller molecules like that to enter the tissue. So this is how you get the fluid into the tissue. Then you would, let's see here, how do I go to the next? Then you would ask, and the people asked that about 100 years ago, what are really the drivers, what are the principles? And I think most of you have heard the Starling principle, where you have that the pressure within the arterial end of the capillary would drive fluid in, and then you would have osmosis, according to the Starling principle, basically sucking the extra tissue out, or the extra fluid out. That's not the case. So most people in the field of tissue fluid transport are now believing that almost all the excess fluid that enter would leave by lymph vessels. And lymph vessels, of course, are blinded in capillaries that by several mechanisms would take up the excess fluid, and then it would eventually be transported back to the general circulation by the smooth muscle cells in the lymphatic vessel that can constrict. So in combination with valve, this low pressure system would continuously drive fluid through here. But what about brain? So if you look at brain, I can try to go into this modulation here. Brain is of course special because the brain decided at some point to use glutamate, that is a very common amino acid. It's present in blood, it's present in peripheral tissue in almost millimolar concentration. But brain decided for unknown reason to use that as its primary excitatory transmitter. And that means that the brain, first of all, need to have an awful lot of glutamate transporters to basically lower the concentration. And this is just shown here where you see the very common astrocytic glutamate transporter that already at embryonic stages are expressed exceedingly high in the entire nervous system. Of course, that's not enough. You also need barrier. And just to look at barrier, it might be useful to look at Drosophila, because Drosophila is one of the first multicellular ganglion-like organization. And you would here have a barrier that's called the septate junction that basically make a tight barrier around it. And that would prevent glutamate and other what's called molecule that can be regarded as transmitters from entering this kind of ganglion. What I really like about this is you also have, in even such a primitive brain, you actually have in-sheeting glia that become our oligodendrocyte. No, that's the enwrapping glia. The in-sheeting glia are the satellite glia. It's very nifty to see how the glia cell have already differentiated to subserve various functions to support neural transmission. So in essence, you isolate this brain or this CNS from surrounding tissue, and what is it surrounded by? That is the hemolymph. So what is a hemolymph? The hemolymph is basically blood, it's fluid coming in, and it's waste getting out. So all of the transport of metabolite and waste would occur along these basically tight junctions here. Very, very interesting. So what about our brain? So we have multiple brains, but they're basically replicating what you see in the fly. We have, of course, a blood-brain barrier that we all know about, but we have multiple other barriers. We have in the choroid plexus, the epididymal cell makes barrier made of many different claudins. And we have in the leptomeninges, on the arachnoid barrier layer, we have claudin 11 forming a very tight barrier. So again, we have a central nervous system where we have very tight control of things going in and out, but within the central nervous system, there's no barrier. And I think that's an important principle. So there is almost free access for CSF molecules to enter and exit the brain tissue. And that is because that both the epididymal and the PL membrane are without any tight junctions. So very interesting. So now the brain have a problem because we have very highly energy-demanding synapses located up to 30 micrometer away from a capillary. But that capillary have a tight junction. It's not going to allow vascular fluid to enter the tissue. That's exactly the function the blood-brain barrier have, to not allow function. So what did the central nervous system do during evolution? It basically created its own system of fluid flow. And I think it's remarkable how similar it is to peripheral tissue. So basically it said, okay, we are building a tunnel of vascular structures that are donut-shaped around the entire vascular system in the brain. And this is artery, capillary, and veins. So glia infeed, so these are the vascular infeed of astrocyte, would plaster around the entire vasculature down to the most tiny capillaries. And those vascular infeed are not coupled by tight junction. They're coupled by gap junction, very similar to peripheral endothelial cell. Furthermore, they express very high level of the water channel aquapoint 4 to facilitate influx of fluid in these perivascular spaces that's created by basically having two vessel walls, an outer one that's the astrocyte infeed, and the inner wall that is the vasculature. So And the reason Aquaporin 4 is kind of interesting is that peripheral endothelial cell express very high level of the water channel Aquaporin 1, again to facilitate influx into the complex tissue. So how does it work? It would work this way that you have, for example, glucose is of course supplied by the blood. It is transported by the glucose transporter across the endothelial cell, but in order to reach the synapse in here that demand it, you would need a fluid flow in the perivascular space to basically facilitate the local delivery to that synapse. So then you have another problem, and that is that you don't have a lymphatic vessel in the brain. So instead, the brain have decided to use the perivenous spaces as the primary efflux pathway. So basically, this replicate, it's biological engineering. You have a problem. You cannot allow vascular fluid to enter the brain. You create the choroid plexus that produces cerebrospinal fluid, and you recircle that cerebrospinal fluid to have an internal delivery and cleaning system. But the principle of how it works is very similar to peripheral tissue. So we studied this, and we were really interested in the astrocyte. This is my real interest in it. And one of the major reasons was we wanted to take all this astrocyte calcium signaling that we couldn't really figure out what was doing because it's slow, it's not really been shown to be important in any diseases. And we said we really wanted to study something that of clinical importance. And it's clear that the brain have a major problem with waste clearance, because the diseases of aging, the neurodegenerative diseases, can all be regarded as diseases of a dirty brain, because you have accumulation of different proteins, hyperphosphorylated, misfolded, that would accumulate, and you'd initiate a low-grade neuroinflammation that probably is a major trigger of synapse loss and later neuronal loss in these neurodegenerative diseases. So how does the lymphatic system work? We called it the G-lymphatic system, because the glia cell play a very important role with Aquaporin 4, and they're all located here. So basically it worked in that way that you would have arterial pulsatility driving fluid in along the penetrating arteries. And that fluid, so the cerebrospinal fluid, would enter the tissue supported by the Aquaporin 4 water channel located in the vascular infeed of astrocyte. If you delete Aquaporin 4 water channels, so if you use mice that have deletion of these water channels, or you use pharmacological blockage, you'd reduce the flow by 30-50%. And then you'd basically, by setting up convective flow within the tissue, you would drag any solute. That could be lactate, potassium, amyloid, tau, and synuclein would be dragged out, both along the perivenous spaces, but also along basically cranial and spinal nerves. After we published our studies, two groups shown that very interestingly that the major brain veins, so these are the sinuses located in dura, that those actually have surrounding them traditional lymphatic capillaries. And that was beautiful, because then you transport this waste product, so the fluid that needs to be transported out of the brain, you transport it to these lymph capillaries, and then it can be transported back out. I'll come back to that. So why should we care about that? Again, it's actually been shown that amyloid, tau, and synuclein are transported by the lymphatic system. But also, I want to just emphasize that this is not a system that always works. As we age, the system fails. And this is just a very simple montage of influx of cerebrospinal fluid tracer in a young mouse and an aged mouse. And you can see that at least for the larger tracer, you have an 80-90% reduction in influx, suggesting that brain fluid flow decline exponentially by aging. This has been confirmed in human brain. But then the other reason I think we should care about brain fluid flow is that maybe it's in somehow is needed for all the neural processes we look at as higher learning and what's called information processes. So we did a little study, and this is actually supported by the Simon Foundation. They have an aging initiative. And we just asked a very simple question: how does lymphatic flow relate to basically cognitive abilities of these mice. So we ate mice, and we used here, we have done many different assays, but I'll just show the Barnes maze. And what we found was that if we look at a measure of how smart these mice are, how fast can they get to the escape route, we actually did not use the speed because we found old mice move much slower, so we instead used the distance of travel to get to the escape hole. We found it was linear correlated with CSF tracer influx into cortex. We only looked at cortex here, but it's also correlated in other areas, but most strongly in cortex. And I think this is remarkable. I'm not stating that brain fluid flow drive cognitive abilities, but I think it might be a foundation to maintain cognitive ability in aging. So I just want to show a couple of examples of glymphatic flow. And this is one of our first studies that was headed by Jeffrey Liff, who now is in Seattle. And he did something extremely simple. He just injected a CSF tracer. And then he saw, does it really enter the brain? And in this case here, he have injected, in addition to a CSF tracer that screen, he first stained the vasculature by injecting IV a red tracer. So you see here the shadows, I don't know whether you can see it, but there's a shadow of a pial artery. And then for each of the penetrating cortical arteries, he placed an arrow. And what you can see is that this CSF tracer would enter along the pial artery and very quickly dive down into the perivascular spaces surrounding the pial artery. It never goes in along the veins. So the most surprising about this movie is not that it happens. I think it's engineered to happen like this, but it's actually that the fluid extent is so fast that this is a movie that's just 15 minutes long and compressed to 30 seconds. So it's a very fast fluid exchange. It's not diffusion, it's clearly convective flow. So what drive it? And that is actually fairly easy to approach. So we work with a group of mechanical engineers that have studied fluid flow in the outer solar system. So we got them interested in this. This is Dr. Kelly and Jack Thomas. And we got them interested in this subject, and we have collaborated with them since then. And what they told us was that, no, we cannot look at tracers because we cannot track a tracer. We need microspheres so we can track them. And here is one of the movies a student, Humberto Meister, created, where we basically injected microspheres that's large enough to track them. They emit enough signal so we can track them at a very high speed of two photon emitting, so 30 hertz. And if you do that, so you can get here plot the velocity of the microsphere just by particle tracking here, and you can compare it to the cardiac pulsatility and respiration. And just by looking at the tracers, microsphere, you can see they don't move with an even speed. They speed up, slow down, speed up, slow down. And that is clearly driven by arterial pulsatility. So every time you have a systole, the R wave, you basically just pulse this microsphere forward. You can also see the microsphere are not that great because some are big, some are small, the aggregate. So it's basically all aggregates. But that is actually a key observation because one of the hallmarks of convective flow is that small aggregate move with the same velocity as the last aggregate. So this is not diffusion. And the other thing I just want to point out is that the perivascular spaces here along a pial artery, they're huge. In areas, if you look at it down with your two-photon microscope, the area of the perivascular spaces are actually larger than the artery itself. We don't see that when we fix the brain and we look at that tissue. And that is why this fluid system has not been discovered before, because what happened to fluid-filled spaces is that they disappear because you're dragging with a hyperosmotic formalin-based fixative. You're dragging all fluid out, and the perivascular spaces collapses, and they're actually described as a basal lamina that is a few microns thick. Instead, they're actually large in real life. So we wanted to move to a more clinical relevant platform, and we work with Helene Benveniste at Yale University. And she basically replicated glymphatic studies using MRI and injection of a contrast agent into her cisterna magna. And what you can see if we have shown the movie is that you have clearly vascular. This is the anterior, the middle, and the posterior cerebral artery. You clearly perivascular influx. And also that this 2 hour movie long, this movie is 2 hours long, and you can see the influx phase is basically over after half an hour to 40 minutes. So again, very fast fluid flow. So while we're doing these studies, we start to ask, how can the brain both pump so much fluid around? Because pumping fluid around is extremely energy demanding, because you have to transport it across plasma membranes, and thereby you also have to transport ions. And at the same time, have a brain that do all what we expect a brain to do with regard to information processes. And at that point, we realize we have only been looking at anesthetized mice and rats. So two young students in the lab, Lulu Xi and Hongni Kang, modified our setup for the two-photon microscope to measure EEG and also inject different color tracers. These are 5 kilodaltons, so about the same size as beta amyloid, but inject them at different state of brain activity. So here we have a mouse where the delta wave prevalence is low. It's awake. It's sitting on the stage, and we gave it, in this case here, ketamine xylazine anesthesia to so it lost consciousness. Opposite, the mice tend to fall asleep. They're well-trained, and we could wake them up by puffing air on their tail or just touching their tail. So here's one of the movies I created where we have filled the vasculature with a blue tracer. And what you can see, if you look at the sleep state, so this is natural sleep, you'd see first the PL arteries outline, and then very quickly the tracer dip down in the perivascular spaces. So basically a replication of what we had in the anesthetized animal. On the other hand, if you look at the same mouse, the same field, but now being awake, we have almost no influx of the green tracer. So, of course, we were excited about that. We also thought it was a mistake because maybe the mouse is struggling, maybe the needle get loose or whatever. So we have replicated many times, and we actually believe that this is a really fundamental part of brain function. And I'll just show you it a different way. So we moved from two-photon emitting because we are looking at what we believe is a brain-wide fluid transport system in a pinhole. We really wanted to look at whole brain. So we have gone over to use macroscopic emitting. And macroscopic emitting is basically a camera lens. And since the mouse skull is so thin, it's transparent, so you can actually use a regular LED light to image the entire surface of the brain and the cerebrospinal fluid on top of it. So when you look down, you'd see the anterior, the middle, and the posterior cerebral artery branches crawling up along cortex. And if you look at the sleep state, you'd see here, this is half an hour movie long, you'd see very quick filling, as I showed you before, of the cerebrospinal fluid tracer that injected down here. So it's pretty far away. It's actually 2 centimeters away. So it's a very active transport. This is a head-fixed, very awake mouse. And I still think it's one of the most remarkable things I've seen, and that is that the awake brain is completely capable of suppressing influx of fluid. And this, I think, is something we really need to figure out how that occurs. We know some of it, but the awake brain does not allow fluid influx. And it's probably because fluid flow, active fluid flow in the extracellular space would probably reduce the position of synaptic transmission that depends on chemical mediators. But that's, of course, still active. Does it exist in human brain? I'll just show a few examples. One is from Per Eide and Gert Wengstedt's group at Oslo University. And they were allowed to inject contrast agent into patients. These patients have various diseases, so they're looking for CSF leaks. And some of the patients did not have a leak, so they regard them as actually controlled people. And what you can see is, yes, you have influx of the contrast agent into the human brain, but it looks like it occurs much, much slower than it does in the mice. You first have complete influx after 24 hours. But these two investigators, of course, said, what did our patient do? They were, of course, awake during the day, and they went home to sleep. So they repeated the study where they included a sleep-deprived group here. So they were sleep-deprived the entire night. And they had actually, I think, a kind of scaring message to us. So what they observed was that the sleep-deprived group cleared the contrast agent slower. Maybe not a big surprise after one night of sleep deprivation because the glymphatic system is shut off. But after this one scan in the morning, so 24 hours after injection, the subject were allowed to go home and sleep as much as they wanted. And then they were scanned at the second day. And the second day, they still observed a significant higher level of the contrast agent within brain than in the control group that have slept normal both at the first day and the second day. So if you have a night out, you probably need to recover for several days after that. And then I wanted to show this beautiful study from Laura Lewis' group. She just moved with her group to MIT, and she actually did a very fundamental observation. And that was that every time, so these are healthy subject that are encouraged to sleep in the scanner. And they're encouraged to sleep not only in the scanner, but they've also mounted an EEG electrode, so it's very uncomfortable. But she was actually able to get many of them to sleep. And what she observed was that if she imaged a bold signal here, so this is functional MR imaging, she observed this called slow wave activity that occur in non-REM sleep one and partly in sleep two. So light non-REM sleep. And this is basically that the entire cortical network fire at the same time. And that induces a huge functional hyperemia that you detect here as an increase in bold signal. But what she found was that every time after that happened, you had a movement of cerebrospinal fluid in the fourth ventricle. So why did that happen? That probably, and this is plotted her data, so basically the bold signal was anticorrelated with CSF movement in the fourth ventricle. And she made this pretty nice equation here, where you have slow wave activity increases blood volume, and thereby it increases CSF flow. So why does that happen? And this is so smart. This is, again, biological engineering. That happens because we have within the skull, and of course our skull is rigid. We cannot change the property of the skull. But we have within the skull, we have the brain, we have blood, and we have CSF. Brain is non-compressible. So if you suddenly have an increase in blood volume, the only thing you can move is CSF. So blood volume is a driver of CSF. And I tried to illustrate it here. I hope it would run. So you have, every time you have a slow wave activity, you have an increase in blood volume, and you have movement of CSF. So this is every time you really think very hard about something. It could be local, because it can also happen local. You're expanding your brain, and that is moving CSF. And that happened on a local level because the blood, the arterial diameter expand and pressure CSF. And then it's actually so cleverly made that CSF is running in when the vessel constrict, but the only way it can go is to the astrocyte infeed with aquapoint-4, and it's pressing the fluid into the brain. Very clever engineering. So I think it took us many years to really realize how important Laura's observation was. And then I added this little movie here that is a brain scan, and this was for you that talked about movement. And this is brain pulsation generated by the very large arterial supply to the brain. So brain is, as you all know, very soft. It has almost no connective tissue. And it's laying on top of the circle of Willis. That's a huge arterial supply. And every time the heart beat, the entire brain moves. And since blood in these large artery moves with a speed or velocity that is 1 to 2 meters a second, the entire brain would pulse at the same time. So both your neuronal cell bodies and your axon would pulse almost like your magnet. So I think you actually did the right experiment the way you had done it. The question is, why is CSF reduced during wakefulness? And this is a little nerdy, but I wanted to go over it because this is what we know. So anyone that deal with fluid transport know that resistance is everything. And we thought very simplistic, maybe when we awake, that the brain cells are larger and thereby the extracellular space is smaller. And with a smaller extracellular space, you'd have more resistance toward fluid flow, and that would reduce influx of fluid into the brain. So in order to test this hypothesis, we worked with Charles Nicholson from NYU, and he have developed a quantitative assessment of the extracellular space. And this model, you basically take a little cation. It's called TMA. It's just a little cation that cannot pass plasma membranes. You inject it by iron-2-phosphorases into the brain here. And then you have an electrode positioned 100 to 150 micrometer away where you measure TMA. So this electrode has ionophore, so it can measure TMA arriving. So if you have a very small extracellular space, the TMA would reach the recording electrode faster, it would rise faster, and the amplitude would be higher. It's simply less diluted. If you, on the other hand, have a larger extracellular space, everything is dampened because you have more dilution. So we did this, and what we observed was that in the sleep state, we had a much, much larger extracellular space volume than we have in the awake state. We have not published it yet, but a collaborative study shows that it's primarily astrocyte that changes sizes when we enter wakefulness or during arousal. So both natural sleep and all the type of anesthesia we have analyzed have a very significant increase in interstitial space volume. Other techniques such as EM, and also diffusion-weighted images using MR have supported these observations. But so far, we are the only one that have used TMA electrode in sleep and awake. I would love somebody to go in and try to do it. So what drives the shrinkage of the interstitial space? Very simple. We all know that our arousal system, we have many mediators, as we just discussed. We have dopamine, acetylcholine, but the only nuclei that if you stimulate them that wake you up in seconds is locus coeruleus that produce norepinephrine. Norepinephrine is clearly our arousal modulators. And what we did was that we tested the effect of a pan-adrenergic receptor inhibition, and we use alpha-1, alpha-2, and beta receptor antagonist. So we basically applied it locally in brain and asked how much the TMA signal changed, and we saw that if we added this cocktail on norepinephrine receptor antagonist, we could increase the extracellular space volume. It's called alpha here. This is how the equation is. But we could increase it in a otherwise awake mouse that was all local. So clearly norepinephrine drives these volume changes. It's actually not a surprise because in the peripheral tissue, it's known that norepinephrine drives kidney transporters. It drives potassium secretion from the heart. There's a whole bunch of literature on that. So it's not a big surprise. But most importantly, if we gave this noradrenergic receptor antagonist cocktail, we could also increase lymphatic flow. So at least the extracellular space volume plays a major role in the arousal-mediated inhibition of the lymphatic system. So now we have a tool where we can modulate the lymphatic system. So we really wanted to study what happened when could we use this in a clinical condition where norepinephrine gets very high. And we all know norepinephrine is high in attention deficit. You know, you are distracted. It's high when you have the startle response. Many different conditions, but they're transient. And we really wanted to show the clinical significance of this. And I will try to convince you why you should care about it. And that is traumatic brain injury. It's very far away from what most of you do. But why is it important? It's actually really important if you're studying aging, because 50% of all elderly have been exposed to traumatic brain injury, and many of them multiple times. So when we are using control mice, we give an enriched environment, we should actually shake half of the cages when we are studying natural aging, because traumatic brain injury is a very, very common event. For us, it was interesting, because the severity of the edema, and this is all to do with the glymphatic, is the best predictor of outcome. The faster and the more severe you develop edema, your worse prognosis you have. And the only treatment you have these days is basically to take part of the skull off and let the brain swell. But the outcome are debatable because you probably have only patients that survive with so severe deficit that it is a huge burden on many, including themselves. So Rashad Hussain in the lab have used our model we call hit and run injury. And why do we call it that? We call it that because we really dislike the common traumatic brain injury model where you anesthetize a mice, you mount them with head bar, and you smack something in the head. Because this is not how you experience a head trauma in real life. In real life, you're not anesthetized and you have not fixed your skull. So we have developed this method where we can actually induce it in awake mice, where we have moved the piston 90 degrees and we hit the mice here on the side and they fall down. And one of the beauty of this model is you can do a complete neurological exam seconds after. And it mimics, because, for example, how much it's actually shown that females suffer more injury when they get a traumatic head injury because their necks are shorter and their muscles are you cannot be anesthetized. You also have no protection from anesthesia. So I think it's really a key to study traumatic brain injury, not developing possible way of treating it for anesthetized mice. That's one of the key. We are actually here using Rashad decided to anesthetize them for 10 seconds when they're hit by the by this rod here. So they're anesthetized, but they wake up as soon as they hit the ground, they wake up and we can look at them. So the first thing we ask is, does norepinephrine as reported in the clinical literature, does it really increase so high and so consistently and so prolonged in our model? And here we measured norepinephrine in the brain using microdialysis, and you can see we have these huge peaks that several thousand-fold increases in norepinephrine in brain. But it's not limited to brain, because if you collect plasma, you'd find that norepinephrine also, or noradrenaline, increases very significantly in blood. Clinical data have showed that this norepinephrine spike are maintained for maybe weeks after the traumatic brain injury. So now we have the tool to basically manipulate glymphatic flow. We have this pan-adrenergic receptor antagonist we call PPA. So what we did was that we measured edema in the brain at different time point after we exposed the mice to traumatic brain injury. And we plotted both the ipsilateral, so the site that was hit by the rod, versus the contralateral. And you can see there is an increase in brain water content as a function of time. But most significantly, if we added here in purple the norepinephrine receptor antagonist, we could actually completely eliminate edema. And this is kind of counterintuitive because we know that increases glymphatic flow and we would expect that was worse in the setting of traumatic brain injury. But this is the observation we found many years ago. We have worked very long time to understand what's going on. So we also did a lot of follow-up studies to see what effect does this norepinephrine receptor antagonist have. And I'll not bother you with all the behavioral assay, but you basically have here the control compared to traumatic brain injury that received vehicle versus, say, PPA-treated mice. And all behavioral assays, they basically did better. So the outcome was better. So then we said, okay, we have really misunderstood norepinephrine's role in the glymphatic system. So we went in and looked at glymphatic flow. Here, look with the macroscope down, and you can see traumatic brain injury very, very significantly reduces inflow of cerebrospinal fluid tracers, in particular into cortex that's hit it on both sides. But PPA really did increase glymphatic flow, and that is just plotted here to have statistics. So how do we reconcile these two observations, that PPA treatment restores glymphatic influx, thereby CSF influx into brain, but it actually eliminates edema? So here we continue to work, and we ask again a very nerdy question, that is, what is the source of the edema? And we have basically two sources. We have blood, so we have the vascular fluid, and we have cerebrospinal fluid. And we, in order to investigate those compartments, we injected radioactive sodium, because sodium is very, basically, sodium chloride is a major ions in both fluid, both vascular fluid and CSF. And I will not go over the details, but the bottom line was that neither blood or CSF is the source of the edema. So where is the fluid coming from? Then we ask, okay, maybe we have increased CSF production. So we measured CSF production, these mice. This is a new method we have developed where we very accurately can directly measure CSF production. And we found that after TBI, we have very, very significant reduction in cerebrospinal fluid production, and the PPA treatment actually restores it. A lot of variability, but it restores it. So if we cannot identify a source of the edema, the only reason for the edema must be that fluid cannot flow out of the brain. There's some inhibition after traumatic brain injury. And of course, our interest was, is norepinephrine here involved? So we have a technique where we can measure efflux from the brain. This is again, I will just explain it very quickly, but it's actually very difficult to measure efflux from the brain, because if you want to measure efflux, you want to bypass influx. So the only way you can do that is to inject directly into the brain. So you have to implant a little cannula 4 to 7 days before, because otherwise the acute injury from the implantation would affect brain fluid flow. But then you also have to inject a tracer you can detect as it flows out. Because injecting a tracer and then measuring in the brain how much is left is extremely, costly in form of animals. Because each animal is one point and you want to make a time course. So we developed this technique where we inject a little blue tracer. And that blue tracer, it's Evans blue, it actually binds pretty irreversible to albumin. And since albumin is not excreted from the blood by the kidney do not want to get rid of albumin, all the Evans blood that leave the brain actually accumulate in the blood circulation, and it stays there for days. So you can basically look at the collected efflux from the brain, from either lymph vessels, from cranial spinal nerve, from perivenous bed. Anyway, all vote goes to Rome, and that is the vascular system, and you can look at the increase in this blue tracer in just peripheral vessels. And here we look at it in the femoral artery and veins. And as you can see, after TBI, we have a decrease in efflux that's restored with PPA, and that is plotted here. So it doesn't restore completely, but it's clearly better. So we have a very significant reduction in clearance from the brain after traumatic brain injury. So at that point, we said, okay, we really want to know a little bit more about the cellular mechanism by which we have reduced the flow. So we started to image the efflux pathways that are the cervical lymphatic vessels. So in order to do that, you basically anesthetize the mice. We have to anesthetize them. We cannot do this wake. And we would flip the skin away. And then we would inject cerebrospinal fluid tracers and particles into cisterna magna and then image what's going on. And it's a beautiful imaging. And you right away realize that lymphatic vessels are really primitive. They do not work like blood vessels. You see these particles going up and down. And basically, you have these lymph angiomas with smooth muscle cells. They would constrict. The valve would open, it would go to the next. So the coherence of these constrictions have to be very well organized. Otherwise, you would basically not get any efflux. So when you do that, you can, here we have in a control, we have here microparticles or microspheres, and you can see they go both ways. And this is how they work. It's primarily downward. So it's all dependent on the valve function and the constriction. You see very, very slow movement compared. It's definitely not related to cardiac pulsatility or respiration. So this is the vessel diameter, and this is the speed of these microspheres. This is all analysis done by Doc Kelly in his lab. So this is how it looks like. You think it looks very disorganized, but at least they're moving. So now we go to after traumatic brain injury. And the first thing you would see is that it looks even worse. Basically, the microsphere are sitting there, and it's trying to constrict. You can see all these little, but it can't really constrict the lymphatic vessels. And also, you can actually also see that cardiac pulsatility is up after traumatic brain injury. So if we give PPA after traumatic brain injury, you would see that it kind of normalizes. Not completely normalized, but it gets much better. But one thing we really started to care about as we are doing this, you see all these black shadows here. We did not see them in the control, or we did not see them in after traumatic brain injury, where almost no fluid came out. It was just sitting there. So we started to wonder, maybe brain fluid transport and later lymphatic transport are transporting some of these cellular debris out from the tissue. So in order to approach that, I think this is over. This is just that PPA restores it. But we start to use transgenic mice where we had green fluorescence protein in both astrocyte and neurons, and we found that many of these black particles are actually debris from astrocyte and neurons. So it's probably super important after a traumatic brain injury to really rest. And this is one debate the American Academy of Neurology have, because there's normally you have after traumatic brain injury, the neurologists would come in, shine light in the eye of people every half hour to make sure they're not herniated. But three studies have come out that suggest that if you leave the patient alone, they actually do better on long-term recovery. So it's actually a very, very important that your lymphatic system is turned on to be able to increase outflow. The reason I feel I can state that is that if you do if you compare long-term inflammation in aquaporin 4 knockout mice and controls, so their own littermate, the no inflammation after the traumatic brain injury is prolonged by months in the aquaporin 4 knockout mice. So that's why I was saying that. But then I just wanted to show here that we are able to replicate the effect of norepinephrine that reduces efflux from the brain by simply adding norepinephrine at the exposed lymphatic vessels. So we believe that the norepinephrine-mediated inhibition of lymphatic vessels and probably also brain fluid flow is a important factor to take into consideration. So we are suggesting that at least in the acute phase, it would be beneficial to treat with norepinephrine receptor antagonist. And why might this be clinically relevant? It is actually very relevant because in the clinic, the neurosurgeon would these days, they would actually inject epinephrine, that's an alpha-1 adrenergic receptor agonist, to get blood pressure up. Because traumatic brain injury patients suffer often from low blood pressure. And they would state, we need the perfusion pressure up to perfuse the brain. But they're inadvertently probably aggravating the edema. And there's actually clinical studies that suggest that that happens. But I think I've run out of time. I don't know how it is time-wise. 2 minutes more?
Yeah.
Yeah, then I just wanted to talk about a little story we published earlier this year, and that is that brain fluid transport in the subarachnoid space is also organized. So we have, so this actually relates again back to traumatic brain injury and also to aging. So we always know that we have a huge subarachnoid space filled with cerebrospinal fluid. And we are always wondering, how can we have so nicely organized brain fluid transport in the brain and not outside? It's just like almost a hemolymph in Drosophilus. It's just floating there. So we start to ask, maybe it's more organized than it is. And for that, we worked with Kjell Mølgaard, that is an amazing professor. He has been the dean and rector of Copenhagen University for a total of 16 years. So when he retired, he said he wanted to go back to research, and his life interest is barrier of the brain. So he went back, and we gave him a POX1 reporter mice, and he prepared this beautiful paraffin section where you still have the skull in. So POX1 is a basically a lymphatic promoter. It drives lymphatic fate. So basically you use them to find lymphatic vessels or lymph node. And he found, you see here, beautiful lymphatic vessel here in the neck. But then he had been looking at the brain for so many years that he saw, wow, there's a POX1 positive membrane surrounding the entire brain. And that had not been described before. And immediately he said, that is something special and maybe, again, similar to peripheral tissue, because it's known in peripheral tissue that you have a mesothelium that surround both the body cavities, so pleura around the lung or the pericardium, but also the heart and the intestine, the kidney, are all covered by a mesothelium. And the idea is that this mesothelium is both important for the immune protection of the organ, but probably most important for friction, because every time we move, we are moving our organs, and this has to glide against each other. So this mesothelium expresses a lot of glycoproteins that bind huge amount of water. So he said maybe the brain has a mesothelium. So we said, okay, we don't believe in fixed tissue. We really have to image in vivo. So we had several students working at this project. And what we found is, so now we are stepping, we are using the two photons microscope to not make a time movie, but just step down to cortex. I just wanted to show how beautiful this mesothelium is in brain. So first we see collagen fibers, we see in the vasculature, in dura. And see, now here, this mesothelium shows up as a beautiful one-layer structure sitting on top of the PL arteries. And this is, of course, at the part of cortex. So it's sitting, so it's a membrane that's located between dura and pia. And it's basically sitting on top of the PL vessels. So we called it the subarachnoid lymphatic-like membrane because it expressed some lymphatic markers, but not all. Just to have a name. And this is just shown here, where you can see this membrane we call SLIM, is sitting in between, basically dividing the dural vessel and the PL vessel up. And you have always dura on top. And we characterize it in great details. The most interesting, I think, about it is it's actually a barrier. So if we very carefully in POX1 mice injected microsphere by cisterna magna injection and let them transport by the lymphatic system to along the entire vasculature. And we at the same time lifted dura and injected another color microsphere on top. We saw that they separated them. But these microspheres are 1 micrometer. And what is more important is to look at smaller molecules like synuclein or tau that are 50 to 80 micrometer. So we did another study where we injected a 3 kilodalton tracer, just in cisterna magna, let it transport by blood. So this is all lymphatic. You see how beautiful the perivascular spaces are here. The only reason these perivascular spaces are so large and big is because it's a live mouse. As soon as you fix this mouse, it would constrict and be a basal lamina. So it's one of the important things to study in vivo. And then when we did C-stacks to look at how it distributed, we found, yes, it's perivascular. These black shadows are the PL vessel, but it's always separated by the SLIM membrane here. So it acts as a barrier for even very small molecule. So what we are proposing is it's almost like a tent in the subarachnoid space that facilitate that the clean CSF produced by in the ventricle and exit into cisterna magna is transported up along the PL artery and separating it from the larger subarachnoid space. We also have another function is probably immune, because we have in the bone skull marrow, we have a lot of immune cell being generated. And this SLIM membrane would basically facilitate that they wash out and not having direct access to the brain, because we have a SLIM barrier. There's a little bit, we are criticized. There's a lot of critique about this study here. And one of the critique was that, one of the critique was, no, you're just looking at the arachnoid barrier layer, but we're not, have looked at this for 50 years. And here's one of our argument that we saw the dura, where the arachnoid barrier layer GLUT2 in vivo are actually separated. So here we have a CSF space, a perivascular space, that's the inner subarachnoid space, and we have an outer space. It varies. So why hasn't it been discovered before? Probably because 99% of all histology of brain is done after you take the brain out. And once you take the brain out, you're basically destroying this layer that is resting in this open space here. And again, we believe the function of it is that it basically divides the subarachnoid space into two separate compartments. So basically just organize fluid flow a little bit better. Why is that important? Aging? I think it's incredibly important because if we look at aged mice, this membrane degenerate. And this is ongoing studies. And that means you're actually using the glymphatic system to transport dirty CSF containing waste molecule back into the brain. And that could be one of the reasons that you have seeding of, for example, amyloid plaques, so vascular amyloidosis is actually seeding right around the arteries. So what I was trying to impress on you was that the glymphatic function is, I would look at it as an integrator of healthy brain function. Any insult during the long life of a human, this could be substance abuse, it could be obesity, it could be circadian misregulation, would negatively affect glymphatic flow. Once you have a stagnation of brain fluid flow, you also have a tendency to promote aggregation of these proteins that tend to aggregate. And we know very clearly that aggregation directly suppresses glymphatic flow. So it's a negative impact you have here. We also know, when we made this little one here, we did not know that neuroinflammation directly negatively impact lymphatic flow. So we have it here below, but we should actually add neuroinflammation up here because it negatively affected. So we believe that we can use glymphatic transport as a readout of healthy brain function. And most importantly, for a clear biologist, I think this kind of work suggests that the brain is not all about neural processing. I think neural processing, of course, is the highest brain function we have, but it clearly requires a support system that maintain the normal sleep-wake regulation, because sleep is not just a time we rest. Sleep has a very distinct function and should probably be included in most consideration by neurologists, because essentially all neurological diseases and psychiatric diseases are preceded by abnormality in sleep, from healthy sleep. Anyway, thank you so much for listening for so long. Thank you.
A great talk. So I have two questions. One is, is there any genetic evidence to link the sleep disorder, which actually is a main
So I think it's 60% of patients that eventually would suffer from Alzheimer. 60% are actually preceded by sleep abnormalities. Before they relatively realize something is going on. They would say, okay, they sleep during daytime, they can't go to sleep. There's a very famous phenomenon called sundowning. And that is that the Alzheimer patient would go to bed, sleep half an hour and wake up and be really demented and running around asking for their mother, being really confused, you know. So the cognitive decline in that is very significant. And I think it's 66% of all Alzheimer patients are eventually institutionalized because the relative cannot deal with the sleep disturbances. That it's a major problem in Alzheimer. That I don't know about. I know that different mutation of the ApoB4 has been related to sleep abnormality and also to Alzheimer. That's what I know.
The second question is for the patient who is taking neuroprolifer. medicine, do they have a lower neurodegeneration?
Uh-huh. They have. Yeah, so beta blockers have been very, very popular to treat high blood pressure. And they come in two forms, one that is blood-brain barrier impermeable and one that's where they're permeable. So we actually, I was collaborated on a study where we found that the risk of dementia was lowered if you took beta blockers that was blood-brain barrier permeable. Yeah, so this was on a huge population, like 65,000. Yeah, yeah, and I was just a collaborator on it. But
question in the back.
I couldn't quite hear that.
Have you found sort of any biomarkers that can sample that give you sort of insight as to the current state of or like the efficiency of the glutathione synthetase?
Yeah, so, yeah, so of course CSF markers are the most important. And one of the things that inspired our work was David Holtzman's beautiful measurement of CSF, where he found that during sleep, beta amyloid is lower than during wakefulness, both in patients and in mice. So it clearly depends on the sleep-wake state. We have not found plasma markers, and I think, unfortunately, many of these biomarkers, as soon as they reach plasma, they're degraded. So it's difficult. One thing I think they are not taking so much into consideration as they should is after traumatic brain injury. We believe that most of the brain protein are entering plasma by glymphatic flow. And if the patient is awake and aroused, you'll get a much lower efflux than if the patient is sedated and or sleeping naturally. So the glymphatic system add complication to, for example, traumatic brain injury biomarkers. But for sleep, I don't know what that should be. Yeah, that's a great question. We really want to know what REM sleep is doing. There's a huge vascular dilatation. It's larger than in wakefulness and larger than the slow wave sleep and non-REM sleep. We don't know. It's simply too short for us. We cannot get the mice to fall into REM sleep on the stage like that. So we're using fibrophotometry now to try to understand it, but we don't know. I think it's very, and it's also very interesting that REM sleep dominate in the later phases of sleep where you probably want to mostly have efflux. So our hypothesis is it's promoting efflux, like this huge vasodilatation might be promoting that, but we don't know. But it's also interesting because norepinephrine is very low during REM sleep, of course. So extracellular space should be huge. Mm.
Thank you for the amazing talk. I'm really curious about how the glymphatic system might regulate neural circuit development. Like, I know you had a lot of amazing work in the adult and aging group, but I'm so curious about the glymphatic system and how it might shape the brain pathology and sort of
But that relates directly back to REM sleep, because during development, it's mostly REM sleep. That, like, basically connecting the different part of brain and spinal cord to each other. And you may be able to look at REM sleep as a way of inducing activity and thereby vascular dilatation and driving lymphatic flow. Like, because you don't have a whole lot of sensory input when you are in utero. I would imagine. I don't know. Probably not a lot. You're not eating, you're not seeing, you can probably hear something, but that's about it. Yeah. So I think nobody has really looked at that yet. I know there's people looking at during synapse elimination, they're looking at glymphatic flow and how glymphatic flow is transporting these synapses to perivascular macrophages. So perivascular macrophages seems to really be digesting a lot of that.
I'm still a little confused about what happens to CSF once it goes inside the astrocyte, so epiphorin 4. Is it being sorted or molecules getting stuck there?
Yeah, and that's a great question. Yeah, so we don't know. Also, that's a basic. So all the tracer studies I'm showing, it's all extracellular tracer. So we're actually not following the volume changes in astrocyte. The hard evidence is that if we delete aquapoint 4 or we add an inhibitor, we reduce lymphatic flow. So we believe basically that fluid transport within astrocyte that have a very loose cytosol, you know, astrocyte is recognized in EM from being electron light, having very few like vesicles and that kind of stuff. So in somehow that is supporting lymphatic flow. We're also working with an alternative model where it's not the water transport by aquapoint 4 that's supporting it. It is, if you look at astrocyte, the end feed that is surrounding the vessel, we believe that that the aquapoint 4 expression that's huge. Every single astrocyte expresses like a million water channel, and they form these arrays that can cover 60% of the inner side of the astrocyte end feed. We believe that maybe they are creating more stiff end feed, and every time you have a pulsation, it might promote or facilitate the valve function. They're slipping up, falling down every time you have that. So that is our alternative model. We simply don't know, and we don't have any tools to study it because we can't study cytosolic flow in live mice. It's not feasible. We have tried.
So it seems like the ability of the arterioles to expand and contract is really critical to get that pulsatile flow. What happens when you have arteriosclerosis, atherosclerosis, which are rich tube?
Yeah.
Do you mess with that?
Yeah, you reduce it exponentially. The stiffer your artery gets, the less fluid flow you have.
And then just the whole notion of atherosclerosis and arteriosclerosis got a huge impact.
Yeah. Yeah, so arteriosclerosis doesn't really affect brain vessels as much. The brain vessels have less elastin. So they're very different composed than outside. But they clearly get stiffer, and they have a lot of fibrosis. So there's many studies showing that now, that vessel stiffening reduces flow. And it's this beautiful engineering. We have one heart, one pump is pumping two different compartments with two different type of fluid. It is, and that's because we have the skull.
Okay, last question.
So locus coeruleus undergo atrophy in aging, but we have actually higher norepinephrine in aging. So if you take any CSF, any sample, norepinephrine increases as a function of aging. And also its metabolic breakdown product. And the idea is that probably the remaining locus coeruleus neurons are sprouting, their projection are sprouting. So that there's higher norepinephrine level in aging.
Great. Thank you so much.
Thank you.